all these White Star Line ships began getting merged into the new Cunard White Star Company, the Cunard Line really wasn't interested in keeping these older ships. They were really wanting to look to the future and not the past. So many of these White Star Line ships were quickly sent to the shipbreaker yards to be disposed of. And unfortunately, this would include the Titanic's own sister ship, the RMS Olympic.
Now, the agreement to merge Cunard Line with the White Star Line was officially completed on May 10, 1934. However, it would still be another year or so before the Olympic was officially retired. In that time, the vessel continued to operate during transatlantic voyages. However, this vessel never regained the popularity that it once had. The Olympic was withdrawn from transatlantic service on the 5th of April, 1935, and this was also the day she left New York City for the last time. She returned to Britain, and she would be laid up in Southampton for a while the company considered what to do with the Olympic.
Now, even though I stated earlier that the Cunard White Star Company wasn't that interested in preserving older ships, it does seem like they were at least somewhat concerned with the fate of the Olympic. Because even though this ship definitely wasn't as popular as it used to be, the ship still did have some popularity among the public, mostly because this ship was the sister ship to the ill-fated Titanic. You see, I believe that in the 1930s, the public saw the Olympic like we see the Queen Mary today. The Queen Mary isn't a huge tourist attraction, but among ocean liner enthusiasts, the Queen Mary is an icon that should be saved and preserved. But we'll talk more about the Queen Mary later. Anyway, back to the Olympic. So several ideas were thrown around as to what to do with the Olympic, and the Cunard White Star actually considered keeping this ship operational and using her for summer cruises. Man, how cool would that be? Can you imagine if they actually used the Olympic for summer cruises? Like, maybe have this vessel and keep this vessel around as a moving museum or a historic museum. I mean, can you just imagine how cool it would be if this ship somehow survived to today? Survived to today, and we could actually see this ship operating like every now and again, kind of like the USS Constitution. You know, they take out the USS Constitution every now and again. However, these ideas were quickly abandoned, and they decided that the Olympic wouldn't be good for summer cruises. So they were trying to decide once again what to do with her. And then a potential buyer came along who thought that he would take the Olympic and turn it into a floating hotel, much like the Queen Mary today. Man, I keep referencing the Queen Mary, don't I? But again, nothing really came of this. So honestly, the future isn't looking very good for the Olympic.
It would be another 5 months before the ultimate fate of Olympic was decided. During that time, the Cunard White Star Company couldn't find anybody who was willing to take on the task of preserving this ship. So with no other plans in the works for the future of the Olympic, it was ultimately decided that the vessel would be demolished. So, around 5 months after the ship arrived, the Olympic was then told to proceed to the city of Jarrow, where a shipbreaking yard awaited it. Here, the Olympic would be demolished and broken up, and her steel and other valuables would be sold for scrap. Now, while it is very sad that the Olympic would eventually be scrapped and demolished, the vessel arriving in the city of Jarrow would bring work for over 100,000 workers who were suffering from economic hardship due to the Great Depression. So while it is a very sad end to one of the most famous ships in history, just think about how much of a blessing the arrival of this ship was for the 100,000 workers who were suffering due to the Great Depression.
So yeah, while I really do hate the fact that this famous ship was scrapped, I completely understand why it happened. And ultimately, I do think that this was the right decision. Because what would you rather have if you lived during those hard times? Would you rather have an old ship just sitting in the harbor, not doing anything? Or would you rather have this ship come to the shipbreaking yard and then have the scrapping process of this ship provide work to over 100,000 people? You have to remember, these people were struggling just to put food on the table for their families. So just think about what that must have meant to all of those families when this ship arrived to be broken up. So while it is a very sad end to the story of the Olympic, I ultimately think it was the right one. So while it is a very sad end to the story of the Olympic, I choose to think of her end like this. What was the purpose of the Olympic? Why was this ship built? Well, it was built to support people. You know, it was built to give them a safe voyage across the Atlantic, provide luxury, be safe, and just be an overall well-built vessel. And honestly, the Olympic did this proudly. Everybody who sailed on the Olympic had nothing but good memories of this ship. Now think of the Olympic's war record. Think about everything she did during the First World War. The ship performed admirably, showing support to all those who sailed on her. I mean, good grief, the vessel earned the nickname Old Reliable, for goodness sake. And then, at the end of her life, she was able to show support to people once again through the process of her being broken up. So honestly, while it is sad that the vessel is no longer with us, I can't think of a more fitting end for good old Reliable.
However, even with the scrapping of the Olympic, this did not signal the end for the golden age of ocean liners. In fact, that day was still far in the future. During the last few years of the Olympic's life, the Cunard Line was working on a brand new revolutionary ocean liner. Now, construction on this ship would be temporarily halted due to the Great Depression, but after the Cunard-White Star merger, construction on this vessel resumed once again. Now, the ultimate question is, what would this brand new ship be called? Well, at the time, the ship's only name was her hull number 534.
Now, there's a pretty funny legend out there about how this brand new revolutionary ship would eventually get its name. But before I tell you the legend, I need to give you a quick little history lesson. You see, the Cunard Line and the White Star Line each had their own system on how they liked to name ships. And in the past, the Cunard Line always liked to name their ships with the two letters I and A at the end. So Lusitania, Mauritania, and Aquitania, just to give you a few examples. The White Star Line liked to do the same thing, but with the letters I and C at the end. So Titanic, Olympic, Britannic, Baltic, just to name a few examples. Okay, so now we're going to get into the legend. Now keep in mind, I don't know if it's true, but if you want my opinion, I think it is, because it makes a lot of sense. So even though this brand new ship was being built under the Cunard White Star Company, where the Cunard Line owned a majority of it, they were basically the one running things. And it seems like they wanted to have this new ship keep the old Cunard Line tradition of having the letters I and A at the end. And it seems like that they wanted to name this ship after Britain's most famous queen, who they were thinking would be Queen Victoria. And this would also match the whole Cunard naming scheme because the last two letters in her name are I and A. So hey, it works. So, in order to do this, representatives from Cunard Line had to go and talk to the king and get his permission. So, according to legend, the representative of the Cunard Line went to the king and said that we want to name our brand new ship after Britain's most famous queen. And then the king misinterpreted that and said, oh, my wife would be delighted. And then the representative of Cunard Line was like, yes, your majesty, that's exactly what we meant. So it was ultimately decided that the ship would be named after the king's wife, Queen Mary. Now, as I said, that's a legend. I don't know if it's true, but honestly, I think it is. Now, this story was officially denied by representatives from the Cunard White Star Company, but still, with everything in the legend, it makes sense. So I really think that this is probably what happened, just no one wants to admit it.
And so it was decided that this brand new ship would be named Queen Mary. Now, what the people who were working on this ship at the time didn't yet realize is how big of an impact this ship would have on the world in the years to come. And that one day, this ship would hold the title of one of the greatest ocean liners of all time.
All right, everybody. Well, hey, that's it for this video. Thank you all so much for watching. And yeah, guys, you now know the complete story of the Titanic sister ship, the RMS Olympic. I'd like to thank all of you for joining me on this ride as we've told the story of the Olympic. And in case you haven't guessed it yet, the next ship that we're going to be doing a new timeline series on is none other than the RMS Queen Mary. I thought it'd be cool to start the story of the Queen Mary at the end of the Olympic timeline series, since the construction on the Queen Mary was finishing up right around the time that the Olympic was being scrapped. So they kind of tie in together. Anyway, guys, thank you all so much for watching. Be sure to leave a like, be sure to subscribe, and thank you all for all your support. Your support means more than you all could ever know, so thank you all so much. All right, everybody, well, hey, you all stay safe out there, and I'll see you in the next one. Have a good night, everybody, and thank you so much for being here.
Thanks to Patreon Captain Level supporter Callum Whaley. Thank you so much for all the support, man.